Good evening. You're watching Urban Debate. I'm Avni Raja. The first issue that we're going to focus on is the economy. Now, we've been talking about the economic slowdown for several weeks now, from a slowdown in the real estate industry to a slowdown in the auto sector. And now people are even thinking twice about buying things like biscuits, soaps, shampoos, even innerwear. Jobs are at stake. Consumer sentiment is at one of the lowest levels in a long time. Companies and industries, both organized and unorganized, have been hit hard. There have been talks of a stimulus package from the government to jumpstart the economy. Several industries have put forth their demands, ranging from a cut in GST to other measures to boost consumption. But now, India's chief economic advisor has called for a mindset change of the private sector. He has also said that the economy doesn't require a stimulus to address the slowdown. These comments have spooked corporate India, which has been hoping for some kind of government intervention. Many, of course, don't agree with the chief economic advisor. As a result of these comments, the markets also today crashed, with the Sensex down nearly 600 points. But the question is, can the economy turn around without the government's help, without some sort of stimulus to the economy? Is it corporate India that's making a mountain out of a molehill? Or is the chief economic advisor downplaying the slowdown a little bit? Let's in fact first listen into what the chief economic advisor said and some of the reactions that came in.
I would say that the private sector in India now, you know, since 1991, we basically are almost now 30 years. So we have a 30-year-old kid. And yes, among that, you know, that there are basically younger kids, no doubt. But a 30-year-old, man, adult, needs to, you know, now start saying, okay, I can stand on my own feet. I don't need to keep going to Papa. Papa mujhe ye de do, Papa mujhe wo de do. This message of basically private sector cannot have a situation of private profits and socialized losses. I think that needs to basically move on. We need to move on. The mindset needs to change from basically as whenever you actually are, let's say, having a difficulty, keep going, keep crying, basically running to Papa, to basically, saying, Papa, bacha do mujhe, that needs to also change. It is investment that really drives growth. Consumption acts as a force multiplier, indeed, but consumption is not the key driver of growth. And that is really important for us to understand. Therefore, investment is what is really critical for us to be able to actually create jobs in the economy. And so let's not the evidence is very, very clear that if we have to have jobs in the economy, we have to have investment, private sector investment, and productivity, and thereby creating jobs in the economy.
Sir, the CEA KV Subramaniam has time and again, in fact, on multiple occasions, he has talked about the privatization of profits and socialization of losses. What is your comment on that?
On that point, I have a complete disagreement with him. What a good economy needs and wants is that the government's policymakers make easy policy which can be implemented and leave the industry free to operate, to be entrepreneurial, to provide its energy, etc. But in terms of a crisis, at times of a problem, the industry has to be the safety net. That's the only way to function. It's the same whether you're looking at defense, you're looking at security, you're looking at currency, you're looking at industry. In all of these, in some, the government plays a more active role, some a less active role, but the safety net has got to be the government.
Well, let's welcome my panel who's joining me tonight, A.K. Bhattacharya, editorial director of Business Standard, Dr. Brinda Jagirdar, senior economist, Milind Sarwate, founder and CEO InCreate Value Advisors, and Professor Aman Agarwal, director, Indian Institute of Finance. Thank you all of you for joining us on the Urban Debate. I want to get all your comments first on your reactions to what the chief economic advisor has said and the comments that he made. Let me start with A.K. Bhattacharya. Your reaction, and obviously India Inc. hasn't reacted very well to these comments as well.
Well, to be brief, what I would say, his analysis is correct. I think there is need for more investment. But I think his conclusion that Indian industry should not be, a crying boy should not ask for SOPs. I think Indian industry is not asking for SOPs. That's where I think I differ with him. His analysis that investment needs to go up, there's no two opinions on that. But I don't think Indian industry is believing in the dictum of private profit and socialized losses. I think the key problem right now here is that the government needs to step out and come out with a policy package that revives the confidence of Indian industry in the policy environment that prevails right now. What is happening right now is probably there is lack of certainty as far as kind of policies that you need to revive investment. What is also not clear is whether the government will be able to effect adequate savings from its own expenditure, which is very often porous and made in a manner that it is not very remunerative for the returns point of view. So can it, you know, effect some savings in its investments and guide that investment to projects which create more jobs, which create a kind of a virtuous cycle in the economy? So I think his analysis is correct, but his conclusion that Indian industry should stop crying and Indian industry is looking for, should not look for support. Indian industry, even if it is a 50-year-old man, I think it will need the support of a sustainable policy environment, certain policy supports. And these are not SOPs. These are essentially packages that you need so that Indian industry can come in and take advantage and make more investments and help the government to revive the economy. So I don't see a contradiction. I do see a problem in his analysis that Indian industry is like Oliver Twist asking for more. I don't think Indian industry is asking for more from what I could make out.
All right, Dr. Brinda Jagirdar, your reaction, because there are two aspects to this as I see it. One, of course, is what the industries and companies and different sectors have been demanding. The other, of course, is what the consumer is going through, because consumption, as we know, has been hit badly. People are not buying things like biscuits and soaps and shampoos. That consumption has really come down. There's a fear of job loss. So that whole mindset of the consumer is the other big factor here.
I think the chief economic advisor was being a little harsh, perhaps. Now, in my view, I feel that, because this perhaps was true, even 30, 40 years ago. But today, Indian industry has really turned around. And I think Indian industry has become one of the most competitive in the world. They are able to go and make their presence felt even overseas. So I think it's not really fair to say the Indian industry is crying horse. We need to listen. There are some really genuine issues there. So I think that's important. A second thing is that how do you increase investment if you see demand not growing? As you rightly said, if I see that there is no demand for my product, how am I going to make an investment greenfield or brownfield? And third point I want to make is that, yes, a government has been doing its bit to create an enabling environment. There has been a lot of, after deregulation, for example, in the banking sector, who to lend, how much to lend, where to lend, all that is now up to the banks. Earlier, this was directed, and there was a whole 28-page document on what the interest rate should be. So now we are moving away, but still there is, you know, things which need to be done. Like, for example, in the labor reforms, for example, there is slowdown, but you cannot close down your unit because you have restrictions. Or a very important point that which is still, I think, which has not received much attention, but which the economic survey highlighted this year. It said that judicial reforms are required, because unless you're able to enforce a contract, that is a real a prime pillar for the private sector. And if you want the private sector, private investment to grow, I think the sanctity of contracts is very important. So there is still a lot of work which the government can do to help the private sector become, an engine of growth, which it can be.
Right. All right, Milind Sarwathy, your opening comments on what the chief economic advisor has said.
I think the CEA was somewhat insensitive, I would say, to the problems which the industry has been really having. I don't think major sops are expected by the industry, as even Professor Bhattacharya was saying. All that the industry needs is a stability of policy. And the government has tended to display a shock and awe kind of an approach. I personally feel there is a little bit of excessive drama in policy announcements by this government. If there is a stability in terms of what the long-term policy would hold out, it would help an important parameter of investments, which is stability of returns. I feel in an economy where consumption is clearly slowing down, how would fresh investments come in? They would come in only if the industry is confident that the current situation is short-term and in the long-term things are going to even out. I feel for the industry to show that kind of an intrepid behavior, you need a stability of policy, item number one. Second point I would make is that there is a lot of social angle to what is going on in the economy today. I feel there is a rural distress on account of even uneven monsoon, and there is an urban distress on account of the economy changing its character from an employment-based economy to what I would call a gig economy. I feel uncertainty of income on part of the consumers leads to uncertainty of consumption. That leads to uncertainty of investments, and that in turn leads to uncertainty of employment. So we are entering a vicious circle, and for turning the vicious circle into a virtuous one, I feel the government has to be sensitive and it needs to look at not SOPs necessarily, but a stability of policy.
Right. Right. And Professor Aman Agarwal, your views, while of course what the chief economic advisor has said can be called a harsh, insensitive, you know, perhaps especially given the situation that we are in, is there, do you believe that there is some amount of truth in what he's saying, or is India Inc. justified, our industry is justified in asking for things that they're asking for?
You see, Anvi, the private sector has been the one which has created the so-called erstwhile Hindustan and this India. It's over 100 years old. It seems that the chief economic advisor is a little unaware of the Indian history and the way India has come into emergence and growth. And most of these companies which are over 100 years old are still in existence and doing great contribution in terms of India incorporation or in terms of contributing to jobs, to growth, and making the flag of India head held high world over at various forums globally. So to say that it is a 31-year-old child, I think it's a little surprising. Maybe he wants to be on Mirror Now and be in debates, and that's where we see his such, novice remarks which have come forth. As far as the concerns of investment, I think the economic survey has come forth, but I'm sorry to say we are not looking at investment. This was a theory which was talked up in 30s, 40s, 50s. We have moved on. The world has moved on. We're talking of financial development, talking of growth. And the concerns which are actually bringing some of these corporations that brim are because of excessive regulations, misnomered regulations, confusions in certain GST structures and others, which have actually created a framework where the corporates are unable to survive and grow at the pace which they're expected to grow to make India the $5 trillion economy, which our Prime Minister has put forward as a focus, as a target for the country to be. Now, if we want to do that, we need to actually stabilize and create some of these norms and structures. And one will only invest when we see that kind of a stability, that kind of a structure where the government is providing that necessary environment which is required for any plant to grow. And that's where I think the cause of concern has been, which has been raised by the industry in the recent past. It is not a question of their wanting some kind of package, some kind of bailout package, which they have come forward with. They have not requested for that so far, and to the best of my knowledge. So I would request and urge the government to provide the chief economic advisor with more information on the history of India, to tell him that how the private sector has actually contributed to the growth of this country for centuries, not for a few decades.
Right, right. A.K. Bhattacharya, I want to come back to you. Also, you know, at this point in time, there is also a lot of importance is given to the kind of messaging, to the kind of words that come out of people who are in the government, people who are governing us at this point. So on one hand, you have the finance ministry, you have the finance minister who's saying that, you know, she's going around and meeting different stakeholders in different industries. There are talks of a stimulus package of some sort to jumpstart the economy. On the other hand, you have the chief economic advisor who is saying that Indian economy doesn't need a stimulus to sort of come out of the slowdown. So when this kind of a mixed messaging comes in, that also adds to all the confusion that's already existing.
Well, you know, on paper, yes, you're right, that a chief economic advisor, after all, is a very important, you know, official of the finance ministry. And if the chief economic advisor says something to that effect, which in principle is contradicting what the government in general is talking about, I think it does create confusion. And I am not surprised at all if the stock market has reacted so adversely, whether it is because of his statement or maybe a host of other factors which are not contributing to the overall well-being of the economy. But having said that, let me say that, you know, the mistake in analyzing what has gone wrong with the Indian economy would be to come forward with some sectoral policies. I don't think you need sectoral SOPs. I think what you need is, you know, a structural change. And if you can bring about major changes in the direct taxes structure, if you can make the major changes on the indirect taxes structure, and if you can make sure that you can, you know, generate some savings from within the government expenditure, because there are studies which are available and which is available to the government as well, but at least up to 1.5% of GDP, that is the kind of investment that is blocked in the pipeline. Mm. The government, even in the best of the governments, are not very efficient when it comes to investing and making sure the investment flow is smooth and efficient and expeditious. So what is right now is happening is that if the government focuses its mind on de-blocking or cluttering that 1.5% of the GDP kind of investment figure and make sure that investment is released without any further delay, in my view, the investment starvation that this economy is suffering from, that will be taken care of to a great extent. The time is not to go in for a fiscal swap of a tax cut of a major thing, but I think it's important to ensure that the tax compliance improves instead of going for tax cut. If you go in for better tax compliance, better tax policies, my sense is you will be able to generate more taxes, revenues. You will be able to create a larger base of taxation. The fact of the matter is, in the last few years, the tax base has shrunk. Tax base has not widened. Your GST, even though the tax base can be widened. So that need not necessarily come from a tax cut, but it can definitely come from better tax compliance policies. So my recommendation is, instead of worrying about whether the India Inc. is asking for SOPs or whether it needs to grow up or not, it will be better for the chief economic advisor and the government to worry about how investment flows can be declogged and two, better tax compliance policies are put in place instead of going in for sectoral medicines, which can create further complications and further confusion.
Right, right. Dr. Jagirdar, I want to come to you here, you know, and specifically as an economist, ask you about this one point which the CEO has mentioned, where he said not to put so much focus on consumption, and that's not really the way to sort of kickstart things. The focus has to be on investment. So my question to you is, do you agree with that mode of thinking that consumption is not the solution, consumption is not where the focus needs to lie at this point?
You know, right now, consumer confidence and investor confidence is so low that we need to get it up. And this can be done through investment. So I agree that investment now, at this point, it is investment that has to take the lead. And government is a major player in the economy. So it's a big player. So it also has a big responsibility. So it can kickstart the economy by focusing on the big ticket expenses, the big ticket investments that it can do in infrastructure, for instance, in defense, for instance, in railways, for instance. All these have multiplier effects. And down the line, the other companies down the line, downstream companies, they benefit and jobs are created across. So I think it's very important now for the government to come out and get its programs going in a big way. This, with this, the sector, the industry doesn't really need SOPs. That's, I mean, I completely agree. What they need is an enabling environment, and what they need is some kickstarting of investment so that they can also come in. One good thing that the government has done, that it is not crowding out the savings. It is not increasing its own borrowing. And so therefore, it is helping the crowding in for private industry. But at the same time, private industry, like I keep saying, it needs an enabling environment. Just jumping a few notches in the ease of doing business is still not enough. Okay, we've achieved something, but there's a lot more to be done. Why is the cost of doing business so high for Indian industry? The taxes, that they don't have power, so they have to have generator sets again. The cost of credit is high. So it's everywhere. Just doing business is so, it's such a marathon effort. It need not be so. I think this is where the government can really help make things easier, make it much more simpler. Access to market, access to products, all this should be something which is without so much of a struggle. And of course, like I said, the first thing is to get investment going so that it gets back investor confidence. And for that, the government has a big role to play.
Right. Milind Sarwate, you know, as far as the confidence of consumers is concerned, that, of course, is the issue, the key issue here, because like we've been talking about and I've been pointing out, people are not buying, people are not consuming because they are scared of things like whether or not they'll have their jobs. And on one hand, you have companies saying that if the government doesn't intervene, if they don't cut the GST, we'll be forced to lay off 10,000 people like what Parle did. What is your sense of, you know, this entire angle as far as the job security part is concerned, as far as companies coming out and saying that unless the government intervenes, we'll have to cut jobs?
I feel the employment issue needs to be viewed from a different perspective. I feel India is a land of entrepreneurs, small and big. And when we have a debate of this kind, we typically tend to focus on larger, more organized industry. What recent times have done is that the informal sector in the country, which actually provides a lot of employment, has been impacted by two major issues. One is the entire formalization of the economy, because the informal unorganized sector was really not into the mainstream of the organized economy. The entire drive through demonetization and GST has brought in a lot of informal players into the formal sector. Secondly, the entire fiscal framework of GST has brought in a lot of smaller players. And I think that sector, which used to provide considerable employment, has been impacted seriously by recent economic steps. I'm not saying those steps were wrong, but there is bound to be an impact on the sector, which is now getting up on its feet and trying to reorganize itself. And when we speak of employment, let's say what the auto sector generates, I feel for every one formal employment that the auto sector would generate in itself, there would be at least 35 to 40 informal or ancillary employments which the sector would be creating. So to counter the CEA's argument, if the auto sector is not doing well, one is not worried about the auto sector employment itself, the direct employment, but also the informal indirect employment of ancillaries. And I feel it is this widespread feeling of uncertainty which is impacting consumption. I feel the other part which gets driven is that a lot of short-termism comes in consumption as well as in investment. And that is not good for a country which has a huge growth potential. So I feel that we have to take the multiplier effect of unemployment in the organized sector leading to unemployment in the unorganized sector. And I feel that the average or the long tail of Indian entrepreneurship is so unorganized and so informal that many of the formal steps do not reach that sector. I feel whatever online or plastic money spread that we have achieved, that has also impacted the unorganized sector. And I feel that the sector is grappling with how to come out of it. And perhaps essentially we'll have to give some time for that sector to recover. We have to also keep in mind that the crores of entrepreneurs that the country would have, they are also consumers. Because I don't think the society has a clear-cut division of producers and consumers. A producer is also a consumer of a different kind. So I feel overall, as the formalization drive gets established in a smoother way, as the fiscal system of GST and the entire drive to increase tax compliance, as that gets smooth roots, I feel we should see a rise in the consumption, and the period till that is going to be one of necessary distress.
Right. Professor Agarwal, you know, the other point, of course, is the interest rates part of it. And, you know, the thought that lower interest rates is what is going to help. But again, there is an issue because the RBI has cut rates, in fact, cut perhaps more than it would have otherwise because of the slowdown in an attempt to help on its part. But that has not even translated into lower rates from the banks. So this whole, you know, talk about the fact that lower interest rates is going to help is not even relevant at this point because banks are not transmitting that rate.
Avni, I think you raised a very critical point. You see, the issue before us today is what is the government expected to do in such scenarios which are tough times which are being seen by the industry and the people of this country. First of all, the government is elected by the people and for the people. So whatever steps need to be taken have to be keeping the people's interest, people meaning the largest interest, in mind before any steps can be taken. And all three measures, it has to be a combination of monetary measures, fiscal measures, and administrative reforms which need to be taken. The current scenario which is getting created lately is not primarily because of, you know, credit offtake not taking place only. It is certainly there because of the banks which were in the PCA and they could not lend, and a lot of things happened because of that. But that's not the prime concern and reason. The excessive regulations in different zones have actually led to creation of this problem which we are seeing lately. And reducing the loans, first of all, the RBI has been doing it in the past, and even now, the banks do not transfer them on the account of maintaining their balance sheets and their asset classes. Secondly, the problem comes up with the fact that even if they do the credit offtake, I have seen organizations take loans at 30, 40, 50%. I remember about 18 years, 20 years back, after the Asian crisis, the ADB approached us for a project, and we did that work where they found that the credit offtake from banks at about 3.5% was not taking place, whereas Indian money lenders, small money lenders, which are giving loan on a daily basis, morning and evening, collecting in the evening, were giving loan at 200-300% to people and small industrialists in the MSMEs in Philippines, and that was taking place. So they were not coming to the banks because of the excessive regulations which got created after the Southeast Asian crisis in the 97-98 in the ASEAN region. Now, please understand that we need to create, when you have a car like an NGT creating a rule of a 10-year and 15-year car, who is going to buy a car? They will naturally not want to buy a car, even if the car is very cheap. I remember about 3-4 years back, it came in newspapers that the US are putting their cars on the beach for people to take it away. So easy credit and everything was made in the US as well. Just making it available, one needs to see when is going to sustain it, going to have it, what is the regulation. An item like a car, a product like a car in India, where 95 to 97% of the population is bought for life, and you're telling that life of that product is only 10 to 15 years. This is excessive regulation. The similar regulations are being put in different zones. Like Parley talked about the other day, that they have been requesting for the last 1.5 years about GST. Now, they've been talking about GST rationalization, but no rationalization is taking place. I have been talking about jobs-based incentives. Why don't you give job-based tax incentives? Switzerland has done it. Some of the Nordic countries have implemented it, and they found that when an organization is posing that I'm giving so many jobs, they should be given and considered for a certain kind of tax incentive to be given to them. And that has been proven to be, it is production linked. Instead of distributing largesse, it is supposed to be benefiting the people. And we have seen economies, smaller case economies, where even when they have low taxes, right, they have seen robust growth.
Singapore has been a classic example. So why can't we, for a short duration, when NPAs are there, when you have a definition internationally accepted for NPAs, when you're having troubles, when liquidity is not easily available because of banks or because of companies not picking up for whatever reason, why can't you create a new definition for at least for the 5, 6, 7 months, like a person when he's in trouble or in hospital, you need to give him some respite. Why can't you create, why are you running after them? They are organizations which have been contributing to the growth of people of this country. They're contributing to the growth of the nation. And right. We have seen, fortunately, that the Prime Minister in the last week recognized this fact and even told the tax authorities and others that you need to keep a compassionate view. You need to be watchdogs. And please try and see how can we help, how can we reduce. And I'm very happy, at least, the fact that the Prime Minister directed and also informed different ministries, including the Ministry of Finance, to go about looking at what is happening and how can we go about finding solutions to the problem which we are surfacing. Every organization, every institution goes ups and downs are there.
Right.
Why can't we try and look at solutions going forward by ignoring? We see industry, you see the CEA has talked about this. We see large industries of public sector undertakings which are in having huge NPAs, which are not able to pay their own debts. They're in having bad balance sheets.
Yes,
now, they have been very old organizations. They have been all sponsored by
government. There for just a minute, because I want to bring in Brinda Jagirdar here. And, you know, the question really then boils down to whether or not India Inc. or Corporate India are companies, industries who have been talking about the slowdown, who have been raising their hands saying we can't do anything until the government intervenes. Are they justified in what they're asking for, or are they making it, are they sort of magnifying the entire slowdown as the chief economic advisor is saying, or is the chief economic advisor then downplaying the seriousness or the gravity of the situation?
I think the gravity of the situation needs to be better focused and better addressed. Today, it's not a problem just within India. Globally, we are seeing a slowdown. In fact, there's a lot of talk of a global recession, going into a steep recession globally all over. So then, therefore, in that context, when we will see global, when we will see countries coming forward and helping their own industries and their own economies to revive, hand-holding, the Indian industry also needs some hand-holding at this stage when there is really a slowdown all around, and especially when demand is so uncertain, when consumer confidence, investor confidence is so low. And also, let's not forget one thing. One of the reasons is that the government itself is not releasing its payments on time. There are many companies which, huge receivables from the government which they haven't yet received. So why don't we speed up things like this so that companies are not in such dire straits and they're neither able to borrow from the market nor from the banks, and the dues from the government which they should legitimately get into their accounts, they have also not been received. So I think at this stage we need a little more compassionate view to be taken. The industry definitely needs some amount of hand-holding, particularly the small industry, the small sectors, which really, really are dependent on the large industry in turn dependent either on the government or the global economy. So all over there is a slowdown, and it's not the fault, it's not as if the large industry is asking for some sops. I completely disagree that they are running to the government saying, help me. It's not so. Look at all the leading indicators which are really staring you in the face and telling you there is a problem all around, not just the rural distress, which needs to be still addressed. But this is now spreading into the urban areas also, urban slowdown, urban demand slowing down, urban jobs being lost. So there is this big loss of confidence which is happening right now. And I think this is when the government needs to step in and make some bold moves and not just run down or belittle the problems of industry.
Right. Mr. Bhattacharya, that point really, that a lot of the smaller industries are dependent on the larger companies, are dependent on the larger industries. And at this point in time, there is no clarity that's coming from, the government on what their stand is, on what their action is going to be. All we're hearing are talks and meetings and things like that. There's no clarity. There is no way of knowing what's really going to come out or how the government is really going to intervene.
Well, I don't entirely agree with your proposition that there is no clarity at the top level. I think, you know, we complain about the lack of monetary policy transmission into real bank lending rates. But I think there is a bigger transmission problem that this government faces. You know, you have the Prime Minister talking about a tax environment, a policy environment, where industries are encouraged to invest more, release their animal spirits. You have the Prime Minister talking about a situation where the tax guys do not chase and cause tax harassments. You have the Prime Minister saying that, don't worry, automobile industry, there is room for both internal combustion engine automobiles as well as the electrical vehicles, so that the demand scenario of the internal combustion engine based automobiles are not really suddenly clouded. You have a situation where the government says that let, the Prime Minister says, and the Finance Minister also says that let there be a proper payment mechanism to expedite payments that are blocked. Now, all these are policy statements made from a certain level. And what you are seeing is that you are seeing a company's laws amendment in which the corporate social responsibilities become a kind of a criminal offense. In a sense, if you don't pay up those dues in a certain times, certain things, it becomes somebody can take you to jail, actually. The officer responsible can take you to jail. So I what I find is this, that on the one level, there is a transmission problem at the policy level. At another level, there is a lack of recognition of what needs to be done. For example, exports is a sector, and we all know that exports are not doing well. Right. Exports last year has been the same as they were 5 years ago, broadly. Now, we have a situation, and it's only now in the last 1 week or so, you have seen some sort of a rupee depreciation, which probably will help to some extent our exporters. But apart from that, our exports to GDP ratio has slid from around 19% of GDP 5 years ago to around 17%, 12% or 14% or like. So therefore, what is being done to make sure that India's export focus gets a new energy, a new direction? So I think there is transmission problem from what the top policymakers are announcing into ground reality.
Right.
And there is also lack of attention to what needs to be done in a critical sector like exports. I repeat that unless our exports grow to level of 70 to 20% annually from the 2% that you were seeing in the last couple of years,
right,
I don't think India's economic growth puzzle can be solved that easily.
All right. I'm afraid we're out of time. Thank you so much to all my panelists for joining us on this important issue. But the question that we're really left with is this, whether or not the government chooses to intervene, how the government chooses to intervene, the point is that there is something that requires, that needs to be done. Because the fact is that consumption sentiment, consumer sentiment is at an all-time low, and something needs to be done to fix that. Whether or not you focus on investments, whether or not you increase spending, whatever it is, the quest, that fear that people have at this point, the fear that's stopping people from buying 5 rupee biscuit packets, that's stopping people from buying soaps and shampoos the way they used to, is what needs to be looked at. And without that consumption, if that is not boosted, there will be lower transactions. If there are lower transactions, the government will make lower taxes. And if the government's tax collections are low, how are they going to meet either their fiscal deficit? How will they take that money and put it back into the economy? So it's a vicious cycle that needs to be broken in some way. And consumption is a key factor in that. But let's turn our focus to the second story that we are talking about today. It's been nearly 2 years that residents of India's toxic hell of Mahul have been battling literally for their lives. Case after case, protest after protest, all to get the state government to relocate them out of that toxic environment that they are being forced to live in. Now, finally, a glimmer of hope seems to have emerged. Bombay High Court has cracked the whip on the state and the civic body BMC regarding Mahul. The High Court has ordered the state and the civic body to take a decision on either rent or alternate accommodation by the 27th of August. And if they're not ready with their decision by the 27th of August, the Bombay High Court will pass an order on the very same day. day. Let's in fact go across to Disha, who's joining us at this point. Disha has been tracking all the developments as far as Mahul is concerned. Disha, it's been a tough battle for the residents of Mahul, but here there seems to be some glimmer of hope, some light at the end of the tunnel, with the High Court clearly stating that one of the two options it has put forth needs to be adhered to, and needs to be adhered to by the 27th of August.
Well, that's right, Avni. We have a timeline now that the Bombay High Court has really directed both the agencies here, the Maharashtra State Government as well as the BMC. 27th of August 2019 is the day when the government has to make either of the decision. Give them 15,000 rupees rent along with the security deposit of 45,000 rupees for 3 months, or give them an alternate accommodation. Here we are talking about 5,500 families of Mahul, and it's been nearly 300 days, Avni, that all of these residents are protesting right here on the footpath, because they have been demanding an alternate relocation, they have been demanding an alternate accommodation, they have been talking to the government for the last 2 years in concern. Let's directly speak to them about what kind of relief they have. Abhi court ne 27 August jo hai uska time diya hai sarkar ko ek decision jo hai wo dene ke liye, aur agar sarkar nahi decide kar payi to court jo hai apna wo order dega. To aapko kya kaisa lag raha hai ye sunke, because ye 2 saal aap ladai lad rahe sarkar ke sath.
Sarkar ke sath hamari ladai to abhi tak jari hai, lekin mujhe pata nahi sarkar apni manmani kya karna chahti hai aur logo ko kahan tak wo pahunchana chahti hai, kyunki maut ke muh mein unhone to hame dali chuka hai. Dusri hai ki court jo bhi decision legi wo sahi और सत्य का साथ देंगी, क्योंकि जो भी प्रमाण सामने आया है वो सब लोगों को देखते हुए और वहाँ के हालात को, वहाँ के सिचुएशन को देखते हुए, और पत्र जो भी एनजीटी आईआईटी हर रिपोर्ट के ऊपर दिया गया है, ये केवल एक बोल करके नहीं है. दूसरी बात, मैं सरकार को बोलना चाहूँगी कि आज जो माहौल में जो हम लोगों के साथ हो रहा है वो सरासर हमारे लोगों पर अत्याचार है. 300 दिन में 3 मिनट के लिए भी हमारे पास कोई क्यों नहीं आया, क्यों नहीं आकर के हमसे पूछा गया कि आप किस हालत में रह रहे हो. बार बार हम उन्हें बता रहे हैं कि हमारे माहौल में लोगों की जान को खतरे, 150-200 लोगों की मौत हो चुकी, इसका जिम्मेदार कौन है. हमारे देवेंद्र फडणवीस साहब जो बोलते हैं संवेदनशील है, और वो हमारे भारत को एक विकसित और विकास दर करके अपने भारत को आगे ले जाना चाहते हैं, तो क्या प्रूफ करना चाहते हैं. जहाँ एक परिवार से समाज बनता है, संसार बनता है, उस जगह पर इन्होंने अभी तक मौन धारण क्यों किया है. केवल इसलिए उनको केवल वादा करना आता है और उस वादे को तोड़ना आता है. वो अपने वादे को पूरा कर सकते थे, लेकिन केवल सिर्फ उन्होंने हमें एक जीआर थमाया, लोगों को सामने एकत्रित किया कि आपके काम करके देंगे. आज उनके पास 5,000 घर नहीं है, मुंबई के अंदर 5,000 छोड़िए, वो 5 मिनट में चाहे तो हजारों घर की उपलब्धि करा सकते हैं, लेकिन वो अपने लोगों को क्यों मरते हुए देखना चाहते, कौन सा षड्यंत्र रचा रहे, कौन सा जाल बिछा रहे, मुझे समझ में नहीं आ रहा है.
Avni, there is some sort of relief, but frustration as well, because time and again state government has asked for some more time, has given reasons like there is no other place available here in the city of Mumbai, and they also cannot give rent as a option, because otherwise every project affected person will demand one, and it will be a huge burden from of course to the revenue department as well. We'll also try and get one more voice. Aapko ye dar hai abhi bhi 27 August bhale jo bhi faisla aaye court ki taraf, aapko ye dar है कि सरकार वापस जाके कुछ स्टे ऑर्डर ले सकती है, क्योंकि हम देख रहे हैं कि 4-5 महीने से उन्होंने सुप्रीम कोर्ट में भी गए, स्टे हुआ, फिर वापस ये जो बैक एंड फोर्थ हो रहा है.
नहीं, ऐसा तो ज़्यादा लगता है कि वो लोगों ने जिधर भ्रष्टाचार किया है उधर वो लोग क्या सोच रहे हैं कि पैसा पानी में जाएगा. सब जो भी लोग उधर नहीं रहेंगे तो उधर का जो डेवलप किया वो पैसा किधर जाएगा. पर इधर ऐसा डेवलप जगह किया कि जिधर प्रदूषण है, उन्होंने कैसा सैंक्शन किया उधर बांधने के लिए. हम लोग मर रहे हैं उधर, हर दिन में एक आदमी मरता है, और जो भी आने वाले दिन में भी मरने वाले. इसके जिम्मेदार कौन है, सरकार है कि न्यायालय है? कोई जिम्मेदार नहीं ले रहा है. सुप्रीम कोर्ट बोलता है तुम ही जवाबदार है, सुप्रीम कोर्ट बोलता है तुम जवाबदार है. और सरकार क्या कर रही है कि न्यायालय के ऊपर डाल रही है कि भाई तुम उधर डाले, तुम लोग मर रहे हो, उनके जवाबदार है. ये आपस में ही ये तुम ये निकालो, नहीं निकाल रहा है, ये सब चल रहा है. अभी क्या है 27 तारीख को क्या उनका स्टर्न होगा क्या मालूम. हम लोग सोच रहे हैं कि हम जल्दी से जल्दी हमारी जान बच सके, हम बाहर निकले, 15,000 भी चलेगा हमको, जल्दी दे दो.
आप बताइए.
हम तो सरकार से एक विनंती करना चाहेंगे, जो माहौल में जो भी परिवार है सब छोटे गरीब है, बच्चे बहुत बीमार है, बहुत सारे लोगों को तकलीफ है, हम विनंती यही करेंगे कि हमको वहाँ से जल्द से जल्द निकाले। हम इंसान हैं, इस भारत देश के नागरिक हैं, तो हमको भी हमारा हक मिलना चाहिए। बराबर है कि यही हम
व्हाट द बॉम्बे हाई कोर्ट आल्सो क्लियरली सेड अवनी दैट पुअर पीपल शुड बी ट्रीटेड विद डिग्निटी। इफ आई कैन जस्ट आस्क माय वीडियो जर्नलिस्ट नितेश टू शो यू, दिस इज व्हाट दे हैव मेड फुटपाथ एज देयर सेकंड होम। दे हैव देयर किचन यूटेंसिल्स हियर, दिस इज वेयर दे स्लीप एंड दिस इज व्हाट दे हैव बीन लिविंग देयर लाइफ फॉर द लास्ट 300 डेज। दे हैव बीन स्टेइंग आउट ऑफ माहौल जस्ट टू लिव अ हेल्दी लाइफ। सो एट द एंड ऑफ द डे 27th ऑगस्ट इज समथिंग दैट वी द कोर्ट विल डिसाइड इफ the government does not really put their stand and decision as to what they are planning to do to 30,000 residents of Mahul and other 30,000 project affected people of Tansa pipeline.
Right, absolutely, Disha. In fact, Disha, if you can also take us through what the Supreme Court has said as far as this issue is concerned, because Bombay High Court very clearly said that the Supreme Court said nothing to do with the relocation part of it. So the BMC and the civic the state government has to adhere to the Bombay High Court order on this. And also, has there been any response from either the state government or the civic body on this?
Well, Avni, answering to the first part of the question, the Supreme Court very categorically said that it did not really talk about the rent aspect, or it did not actually talk about the overall Bombay High Court aspect, because there were specific directions which were laid down and directed by the Bombay High Court as far as rent is concerned, to which the Supreme Court did not really say anything. So that is why the Bombay High Court went on to say just 2 days before on the hearing that it does not substitute the Bombay High Court's order. So at this point in time, the Supreme Court only said that people should not be sent to Mahul considering it's not a place to live in. So that was the overall picture, but they did not actually talk about anything as far as the rent is concerned. So which essentially means that the Bombay High Court's April order this year of giving rent or alternate accommodation still prevails, and that is why the state government and BMC did ask for some more time 2 days before when the hearing was on to that. The Bombay High Court clearly said that no more timeline, and today we have got that date from the Bombay High Court clearly saying that 27th August is the last deadline or the timeline which the government will get to actually spell their decision, because Mahul is not fit for living condition. That is what they have spelled out in the order. Answering the second part of your question as to what the state government has to say, they are completely silent on this particular issue. However, when we spoke to the BMC chief, Praveen Pardeshi, because they are the ones who actually will take care of the entire alternate accommodation process if that is a decision that they plan to take, he said that we will abide by the court order whenever it happens. So this is something that, of course, the government stand is at this point in time, but of course we'll have to wait for 27th of August this year.
Yes, absolutely, Disha. In fact, we will keep a watch out for the 27th and what finally the state government does in fact decide, or fresh orders that the High Court might put forth. Thanks, Disha, for getting us all those details and those voices as well. Well, a third and very important story here that we are bringing to you is about wildfires that are raging in Brazil's Amazon rainforest that have hit a record number this year, with nearly 73,000 fires reported. The surge marks an 83% increase compared to the same period last year. Now, the most recent satellite images show staggering losses over 2 months, with about a hectare of forest land being cleared every minute. And just 2 days ago, there was daytime blackout for almost an hour in Brazil's largest city, Sao Paulo, after strong winds brought in smoke, which blocked the sunlight. Remember, the Amazon is often referred to as the planet's lungs, as it produces 20% of the oxygen in the Earth's atmosphere and is the largest rainforest in the world. To get a better sense of what's happening and how dangerous this really is, Andrew Friedman, deputy weather editor of the Washington Post, is joining me. Andrew, thank you so much for joining us. If you can first tell us what's really going on, how is this different from what's happened before? How bad is the situation?
Yeah, so really what's going on that's different than before is we've had about an 80% increase in the number of fires from January to right now compared to the same period last year. Right now we're tracking about pretty close to a 2016 level of fire activity in Brazil. But the difference is that in 2016, there was a huge drought, and that contributed to higher wildfires and a higher rate of deforestation. Right now, we don't have a big drought in Brazil. And what seems to be happening is a lot of these are intentionally set fires from agricultural interests that are slashing and burning intact areas of rainforest and also pre-cleared areas that they're using to ranch for cattle, that they're using for cattle ranch lands, or that they're using for soybean farms or to grow other commodities.
Right. And Andrew, what's been the kind of response, across the board as far as these forest fires are concerned at this point?
So the response really, the government of Brazil is very pro-development, very much against, they've moved against indigenous rights to land in some of the Amazon region. So what's happening is Brazil is not exactly trying to fight these fires and put them out like you might see in the American West, for example. These fires are burning and they're going to continue to burn. And we're only approaching kind of the end of the first month of the dry season. The dry season goes through October. So the real concern that scientists have and that activists have is that we're going to lose a significant amount of rainforest this year. And once you lose that, you really can't get it back. Mm. And it also emits a huge amount of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, which accelerates climate change.
Right. So, given past data and the way this has really panned out in the past, what's really the way forward? I mean, how long is this perhaps could go on? What are scientists saying?
So it should be noted that Brazil had, until this year, made very significant gains in combating deforestation. The rates of deforestation were held quite low in the past several years. They know how to limit deforestation. They really have done a good job in the past. However, the government that's in place right now is very pro-development and has given signals to agricultural interests that they can pretty much move deeper into forested lands. So what we're likely to see play out is a prolonged period of a very active fire season. Scientists that I speak with say, they don't know exactly how it's going to play out, but they are concerned that we're going to have a record or near record deforestation year. One of the really good things about technology right now is that there are satellites up that we can pretty much observe any spot of the Earth at any given moment. And so environmental groups and government agencies are tracking how much forest they're losing, how much carbon is likely being emitted, even right. If Brazil's government isn't exactly doing the monitoring themselves to the extent that they used to.
All right, Andrew, thank you so much for joining us with all that perspective. We'll have to leave it there. This is, of course, an important issue, and we will continue to track it as well. But on that note, it's time to wrap up this edition of The Urban Debate. Thank you so much for watching. Stay tuned tomorrow night.